thunder, shine on lightning. The days are long and the nights are frightening. Nothing matters anyway, and that's the hell of it. Winter comes and the winds blow colder. Well, some grow wiser, you just grew older. Well, you never listened anyway, and that's the hell of it. Good for nothing, bad in bed. Nobody likes you and you're better off dead. Goodbye, goodbye. We've all come to say goodbye, 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 goodbye. Born defeated, died in vain. Super destructive, you were hooked on pain. And though your music lingers on, all of us are glad you're gone. If I could live my life half as worthlessly as you, I'm convinced that I'll wind up burning too.
Welcome back, Ghouls and Goblins. It's another week of the...
I'm proud of you that you said that right.
I said that right.
I wouldn't have said it right.
I said that right. Well, I said Ghouls and Goblins.
Oh, well, you
did. Not Globlin Theater. Okay. I was calling our listeners the Ghouls and Goblins.
Yeah, and there are a lot of them, apparently. Goblins, We've been killing it, pun intended.
Pun intended.
This month. We might have to just go to fucking horror movies and just dump more action to...
We might have to.
It,
then again, we bucked a good trend. We're doing a good job.
Right. We're keeping the train rolling. And we're at the midway point.
And, of course, thanks, everybody, for joining us each and every week. We put out a lot of content. Yeah. We even throw in the tippy taps. And love all the recent appreciation. And there's plenty more thanking to be happening in the first half here. But the first thing we got to thank is our goddamn lucky prayers. We put out the thoughts and prayers right here on Golan Globus Theater Podcast.
Right.
And that got our president, our dear leader, back up. He's better than ever.
He's 20 years younger. Feels 20 years younger.
I like
younger.
That he is embracing October, and he's out there looking like a goddamn ghoul now. He's doing that for
us. I thought
you
were going to say jack-o'-lantern, because he's very orange.
Yeah, and then he's got like the super white lips.
I thought he was white eyes. That's his
white
look.
White eyes too, yeah. Oh, and then his eye was like swollen the other day, so... I couldn't tell what costume he was going for, but it was clearly cosplay. It's probably just really deep reference.
I think he was going for Swan from this movie.
Going for Swan? If he had the wig, I would have got it.
Well, he does have. He does kind of have Swan hair.
He does. It's shorter, but it's Swan. You're right about that.
All he needed with the glasses. What he needed.
Yeah, the glasses.
Oh my God, if Trump came out with those glasses, I'd vote for him.
I'd vote for him. You are about as. You got about as much commitment as all these other Yahoos you vote for.
Everybody else.
Yes, thank you. Shell is a way better word for it. I was up in Trump country, all the banners I saw and shit.
Beautiful, isn't it? Real America?
Real America.
Finally got out of this hellhole we live in.
A little
democratically run hellhole that we live in where there's constantly riots.
Constantly. I can't believe.
We're constantly replacing the windows at Chateau fucking Golan Globus.
It's ridiculous.
Compound. We got fucking armed guards out.
The laser disc vault, but is guarded by lasers, and the battery level has never been this low. We're draining the shit because we're melting so many people because they're trying to break in.
Right, because they just want to destroy this beauty, this beautiful laser disc thing.
I don't get it. But, you know, this is Obama's America. This is what you get.
This is what you get,
America. This is what you get. Thanks for electing Obama a few years ago. But, Trump country, wonderful place. I saw a 10-car Trump caravan go driving by, honking their horns
at
people.
Where were you at? Exactly.
I can't remember the city. It was like Rose City, west of that area,
wasteland.
Up in Atlanta area. So I was up there quite a bit. Mm-hmm. Beautiful place. Wonderful.
Is it in the thumb? What are you?
No, not in the thumb. It's towards the east side of the upper glove portion, mitten portion.
Okay.
So, great place, but unfortunately, helping my aunt move out of there. Whew. All right. So, yeah, after all that, you know, I got to go see Trump country. It's beautiful. Leaves are changing up there. America, that's the heartland right up there.
You did your American duty, and you came home, and you were rewarded, Griff. What was waiting for you in the mail?
I was rewarded. If you haven't listened to our wonderful episode with Taffy a few days back. Week ago. Wow. Time flies, man. Mm-hmm. Time flies. In that episode, I addressed this problem I had where one of our great listeners and dear friends mentioned to Murray over our wonderful Twitter. What's the Twitter at?
Our Twitter?
Yeah, G&G Theater.
At G&G Theater.
Yeah, and our dear friend Flim Flam at...
We come lovingly call you Flim Flam. It's film fan, but we lovingly call you Flim Flam.
So he sent Murray over a link for the apple available on eBay.
Yeah, it was an Australian eBay.
Portugal?
Well, yeah, but
yeah, that's right. He sent us over to the Australian.
Apparently, Portugal doesn't want nothing to do with America right now, so they'd rather send all their shit to Australian. Either.
Yeah, that's a good point. So, I went ahead, I ordered it, and what I didn't make sure is that the address was correct. I haven't ordered anything off eBay in 3 years, so it went to my old house. So I wrote a nice, kind letter. Hello, resident of the current house I used to own.
Oh, you're miming writing like you actually wrote a letter.
Yeah, this is the only way I can think about, you know, get in the setting I was in. I am the doofus who used to own this house, and I sent a certain record, and I would like to get it back. If you may, please could contact me over at this email address. And he nice enough, you know, kindly returned, you know, emailed me, said, hey, I got it. We can arrange something. It was very short sentences like that.
That's fine.
Yeah, whatever. All that matters is I got it back. And the funniest thing about the whole exchange is he gives me it back. It's not in the packaging at all. And he's
he opened it.
Yeah, he was like...
That's a crime.
Was like, yeah, I thought it might have been for me.
Well, it doesn't say your name on it. You should have called the cops, had him arrested.
I should have called the cops and had him arrested. I was just so thrilled to get my fucking Apple
record. I
think
he was thrilled to get Apple. He was just like, I just want to be in the presence of this
album.
That's
what it was. I think that's what it was, is he realized, oh my God, this is from Portugal. This is the Apple. No one's got this. No one in America.
No, not for what you paid for it.
Yeah.
That's for sure.
That's for sure. And now it's locked up in the Laserdisc. So if you want to eat laser, come try to get it. Because now that I've put it out there, I know everyone's going to be knocking.
Yeah.
There's going to be a lot of melted people on my fucking lawn in the coming weeks.
Speaking of melted people, let's talk about Paul Williams.
He melts faces. He's got a melted face at the end.
Is this your first encounter with Paul Williams?
As far as I know. And I think I'd recognize this mug.
And did you tell me what you thought Paul Williams was first?
Okay. I watched this movie, first half hour of this movie, a year ago. And so the last year, and up until I finally, on Thursday when I watched this the first time through, I thought he was a woman.
No, Paul Williams is a man.
He was wearing the like Hillary Clinton power suits.
They were sweet.
They were awesome. Hillary pulled it off well too.
Right.
Not saying anything here. But yeah, I thought he was a woman.
Yeah, let me.
And especially the kimono the Japanese wear he was wearing.
He had a lot of great looks in this movie.
There is so many great looks in this movie.
Right. Well, I think the fucking Phantom looks awesome. I love that look.
That look, yeah. We never got to it in our Berserk watch through, but at the end, the dude wears the exact same mask, and I was having a good time reflecting on that. I'm going to try to put up a comparison, see who did it better.
Okay. So Paul Williams, Griff, he was a songwriter at first.
He was a songwriter.
Yes.
Okay.
Very prolific songwriter. And he decided, I'm too beautiful to be in the shadows anymore.
That worked into the script.
Right. So I don't know what was in the water. We explained last time with Taffy how the 70s was a weird decade.
Yeah.
And he was, we were talking about Grace Jones in the mid-80s, was like in everything, and then she just disappeared. He was like that in the 70s. So he was in a lot of shit. He was in Smokey and the Bandit.
Yeah.
He was in this. I don't know if he was in the Muppet movie, but I know he wrote the songs for the Muppet. So the Rainbow Connection, that's a Paul Williams.
No shit.
Yeah.
I thought Kermit wrote that.
I remember I saw the Muppet movie at the drive-in.
I was
5 years old. It was Muppet movie and Godzilla meets fights the Smog Monster.
That's an interesting one, too.
Yeah, it was. I don't know why. I got creeped out by it because I loved Godzilla as a kid, even at that time, but the Smog Monster creeped me out. So I was like, Mom, we got to go. I was like, I can't handle this.
I thought you were going to say, these fucking Muppets are creepy.
No, I love the Muppets. They're great. That's when the Muppet Show was on at this time.
So
he was everywhere, and then he just dropped off the planet again. So, yeah, he was a man. Very diminutive, little tiny man. About 5 feet tall. Looked like a hobbit.
Oh,
he makes a great devil or devilish character.
Devilish,
he's not the devil in this
movie. Again, we've been talking about actors who just bring a certain weight to every scene they're in. Ironside. Who was it last week that we were talking about? I don't remember who it was. I know Ironside for a fact. I was talking about it. Right. So we'll just use him as the example.
Not that the 70s cop detective in the wheelchair Ironside.
Yeah, Michael Ironside. Wonderful
Raymond
actor.
Burr, who was in Godzilla.
He Jesus, okay.
No, Raymond Burr was not Michael Ironside.
Oh, okay. Excuse me. So anyways, every time he's in, he just, the smallest little details on him.
There's a lot of small details. He's a very small man.
Thank you, Murray. But
very dainty. Pocket size, fun size, if you will.
I like fun size because you see it's Halloween season, you get the fun size bar. Yeah, so,
exactly.
So he would be one of those. Yeah. But
we know he kind of resembled the what's the word, we mentally disabled character from South Park.
Yeah. Yeah, that works.
I don't remember his name, but he's like the mean one.
Yeah, he's the mean one. I can't think of his name either. We should have probably prepared that. Yeah. So we're just not referencing. We forget every name. I was listening back. I was so tired when we did the one episode, and I was having so much trouble coming up with Audrey Horn and Shirley Fenry or something. It's rough.
Yeah, it was rough.
We're bad at names. We're so bad. So anyways, smallest crack of a smile. Just all the wardrobe, just the way he turns and looks at things. He
flowing
kills every
blonde
scene.
Hair, yeah.
Flowing blonde hair, yeah, sure. Thinning, just barely draped on his head. It could have been swooped over and looked like
Trump. Yeah. You know what? I learned by watching this movie. I was like, where do I know Phoenix, the lead female in the episode? I was like, I know her from somewhere.
Yeah.
She's the lead in Suspiria.
Oh, Dario, yes, Gento's that Suspiria. Is. Okay.
And it's funny because you commented on her dancing, which I agree with.
Mm-hmm.
Suspiria, she was supposed to be a dancer.
She's supposed to be a dancer.
I don't know how.
Yeah.
But.
I've seen that movie a couple times. I saw it in the theater in Toronto when I went there a few years back.
I think that's the last she was ever seen. I don't remember seeing her.
It might
else.
Be. Maybe they actually killed her.
Maybe.
In the movie.
I could see Argento doing
straight
that.
Method. Oh, that the way that one character dies in that movie is so... It's cheesy. It's a great movie, but that death was
It's
awful.
Italians, of course. It's cheesy.
Yeah. I think it was just like, anyways. Oh, should my God.
Should we just get to the trailers
Murray,
and start talking about this movie?
There's so much. I want to say one more thing because it resembles that movie we were just talking about, The Apple, that we talked about five movies. The Apple, though, because The Apple was about evil corporations led by some kind of devilish figure.
Well, it's about the how evil the music industry is.
Yes.
They're both, similar.
Did you like how Death Records, whenever you would see it somewhere, it was just superimposed over shit?
You know why that was? Because originally, and this actually is a better name for it, it was called Swan Song Records.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, Led Zeppelin actually had their label was called Swan Song. So
okay.
They sued. So that's why they had to superimpose.
I knew there was going to be something like that. Because I was like, there's no reason they would have done... With all the beautiful set dressing and everything they did, I was like, there's no reason for this to be here.
Right.
So, okay. But Apple, devil character, the young kids who are going to bring love back into music instead of this
real
high energy
music, not that glossy disco bullshit.
Yeah, that was like getting all the kids hyped up and on Quaaludes and all the speed and everything. Speed!
That's what we need right now.
That's what we need right now. So you have your character come through doing the same thing Elfie did in that movie.
Feeding up an old lady. Remember that part?
Yeah. Oh, geez, that was weird.
Yeah, I don't know. I was like, Phantom.
Yeah,
wow.
You got to calm down there.
Right.
But, this, instead of The Apple where you have this beautiful ending in this movie.
Well, this is the other side.
Different.
This is the tragic side.
Yeah.
As obviously by the title, Phantom of the Paradise, this is a takeoff of Phantom of the Opera.
Yeah.
You also have allusions to Faust and a little bit of Dorian Gray and a little bit of Frankenstein.
Yeah.
It's a lot of gothic kind of horror.
There is so much to look and see and hear. It's awesome. I thought I read that it was the director's like first movie.
Brian De Palma? Might have been. It tanked. It was a huge bomb.
Which is unfortunate.
Well, he went on to make Carrie and Scarface and ton of like.
Damn, okay.
One thing I don't like about Brian De Palma is that he, and you can tell by this movie too, he worshipped Alfred Hitchcock.
Yeah.
There's an homage later on.
Yep.
But he would also always do the split screen shit, which I think Hitchcock did a lot.
Okay.
It was very, like, it was too much. Like, I get it, he's an influence, but sometimes it felt like he was trying to do a Hitchcock
movie. I only noticed
it
the one time.
Well, he does it a lot in Carrie, too.
Okay.
The finale in Carrie, remember she flips out, and then they like do split screens?
That's right.
It's very
It's
jarring.
Been a long time since I've seen
it. I guess it's because they don't do that anymore. It's very jarring if you watch
I really liked how they did it in this movie. I thought it worked wonderfully. But I haven't watched enough Hitchcock to know better.
I'm not a big expert on Hitchcock either, so I can't really say.
But now that we've exposed ourselves for not being huge Hitchcock
experts.
Well,
we're fucking knuckle-dragging retards. We like Gannon films.
That's right.
Right.
So, Murray, didn't mean to burp there. Burp right into the mic. That's awful.
Let's do this, people. Let's go down to that disco and be Phantom.
20th Century Fox presents Phantom of the Paradise, a gothic horror story.
What was that?
A beautiful love story.
Baby.
Like a cinematic odyssey through the rock universe. From Greece to glitter and beyond. The story of a sound, the man who created it, the girl who sang it, the monster who stole it, and the phantom who haunts the paradise, the ultimate rock palace. Phantom of the Paradise.
My music is for Phoenix. Only she can sing it. Anyone else that tries dies.
Phoenix.
Phoenix.
Well, you told me one time that you'd be somebody, that you weren't working just to survive.
Man, you better get yourself a castrato for this.
Paul Williams as Swan.
And the angels that never needed them.
I want you to stop terrorizing the paradise and rewrite your cantata.
And the Phantom. The Paradise.
There really is the Phantom.
Swan. He has no other name. His past is a mystery, but his work is already a legend. He wrote and produced his first gold record at 14. In the years since then, he has won so many others that he once tried to deposit them in Fort Knox. He brought the blues to Britain. He brought Liverpool to America. He brought folk and rock together. His band, the Juicy Fruits, single-handedly gave birth to the nostalgia wave in the 70s. Now he is looking for the new sound of the Spheres to inaugurate his own Xanadu, his own Disneyland. The paradise, the ultimate rock palace. This film is the story of that search, of that sound, of the man who made it, the girl who sang it, and the monster who stole it.
All right, welcome back. And of course, we had an extra treat in there. That's the opening little monologue for the movie.
Right. I didn't know if we were talking about Swan or Kanye West. I mean, it basically sounds like something Kanye would describe himself as.
Right, right. There would have been a lot more God talk in there and how we should praise him, but also he is God. It's very confusing. Very confusing.
So we laid it out. Swan is like a child prodigy, musical prodigy.
He
had a gold record by the time he was 14. So he knows what he's talking about when it comes to music and discovering talent.
Yeah.
So we open right up with his newest, latest discovery, the doo-wop group, Juicy Fruit.
Yep, we heard about them in our nice Rod Sterling open there.
And they're just rocking out. They're singing a beautiful song about a guy who kills himself so he can pay for his sister's operation.
Again, it's so hard to pay attention to the song. You have to watch this movie several times because I didn't even notice what was going on with the song because the backup, his backup singers are like, walking up, there's a bunch of people. They're like on a set, but there's a bunch of people there watching.
Right.
Like they're at a club or something. And they're like throwing women on tables.
The audience was insane in the 70s. They lost their fucking minds when people rocked out on stage. Yeah.
I mean, the one guy like throws the woman up on the table, and next thing you know, he's coming back with a bra in his teeth and stuff. It was crazy. Yeah.
So while that's going on, we cut away for a minute, and we see this fucking, as Samurai Cop would say, geek.
Yes.
He's like covering the banner of the Juicy Fruits, which says Winslow, what was his name? Leech. Winslow Leech.
Yeah.
And his piano or some bullshit like that. And so his whole mission is to take music back to what was pure.
Alfie style from the Apple.
Right.
He's just trying to bring purity back.
So while they're at Juicy Fruits finishing up, we see it. Everyone's waiting. How should we react?
Yeah.
We just see these gloved hands, and because he's up in this room looking down, and he goes.
Whole
and then the fucking
club erupts. Just fucking erupts, and the Juicy Fruits are all proud of themselves. They're like going around passing the peace pipe around. Did you notice I was there on guitar?
No, I didn't.
That was in my mustache days, so you might not have recognized me anymore.
There's so much, like you said, there's so much going on.
There's so much. Seriously, you got to watch this movie 19 times.
So we see this guy. I thought he was pissed at Swan. Apparently, he works for Swan.
Yeah, I couldn't tell what was going on.
Arnold Philbin, and he's like a greaser.
Yep.
And he's bitching about this woman, Annette, that he discovered. He's like, I made her, and then you just took her away from me, and I just want her eliminated.
Yeah, what the fuck?
Anyway, we had a lifelong contract, and you got her out of that contract. And he's just like, baby.
I didn't think he got her out of it. I thought she got herself out of it.
I thought he stole her away. That's why I thought they were like enemies.
He stole her away. But then she was stolen away from Swan.
Because she decided she was going to become some, like, much like Alfie, this hippie and like give away free concerts. And Swan's about the green, baby.
Yeah.
So he's like, baby, please. We don't even need that bitch anymore. If you want her gone, she's gone.
Right.
I've moved on.
They managed to get it worked out in court that you can't sign someone to a lifelong contract, and she got out of it. So, but Annette does. Why this conversation happened? Because Annette never comes up. She's not a character.
We just learn what kind of a character Swan is.
Yeah, and that he likes to give out lifelong contracts.
Right.
So this is interesting.
And we're in the paradise itself. This is going to be, forget Studio 54, this is Studio 55. This is going to be the biggest fucking club wherever they're fucking at. I don't know where this was supposed to be, LA, New York, I don't know.
Who knows?
And they're building it right now, and he's just like, I have to have the perfect singer to open up this club.
And lo and behold, in the background, we're just hearing the music just slowly start to fade in, and it's this piano ballad, and it's fucking amazing.
Hey, the piano man.
Yeah, this guy could have been Billy Joel. It's crazy.
We need to start the fire. And he's like, what is that beautiful music?
The way he bobs his head. Who is that? Is that the Stevie Wonder?
Stevie Wonder, I guess.
Just the way he was just
He's just feeling it, man. Because it's pure. It's authentic, Griff.
It is. And I like that somebody on the organ also knew the music because he started piping in near the end there.
It was a very nice accompaniment.
It was beautiful. I love a good organ.
And he's like, I have to have that music for the opening of the paradise. That is it. Talked him.
You want this creep to open the paradise?
No.
Just the music.
Just the music. He's awful. He looks like shit. He doesn't look as beautiful as I do. Get that music for me.
Beautiful. He looks too young. He also, that's Winslow that, you know, we're talking about here. He also has that is he in his 20s or in his 50s? Like, yeah, it's confusing. And then he also has the
That's why he's... That's why he's an awful fucking front man. You got it. I mean, he can write the songs. He's got kind make the whole world sing.
He's kind of got
ugly.
The early Phil Collins when he still had hair, where he's just got a little bit of chunk right there and then flowing mane in the back.
See, he's thinking, do you know who Christopher Cross is, Griff?
Yes, I think so.
You know his songs, but you don't know what he looks like. And there's a reason for that, Griff.
Yeah, that's a good
point. He had huge hits like in the late 70s, and he purposely did not put himself on the record because he looks like a friend Jerry.
Oh.
So all the women loved his voice. He had the beauty. He would say,
they would just imagine.
Takes me away. Yeah. You know that song. And then his career died when people saw it, which is awful.
Because
I never got like people give Adele shit for being fat or whatever. I don't. Who cares? Like,
yeah.
It's like to me, it's all about the music. I feel bad now that you like that used to be the only in ugly guys had to get chicks was like, well, at least I could like write a song or something like that. And now you got to be good looking to be a fucking singer now.
I will tell you about a certain woman. I saw her a few years back when I went to a festival. She was one of the bands there. It was a wide assortment of bands, but this woman called Lizzo, you might have heard of her.
She's from here, yeah.
Yeah, she's pretty big now. When I saw that, it was
no pun intended.
She's a larger woman, and her whole first album was very her. Her second album was very production because they basically said, "Oh, this big beautiful woman who can sing and belt, and she's also a flautist, so I love that." And so she's playing her ass off, and then the second album they take her, they make her a face of a thing, and isn't this great? And isn't so. Just like this movie, she got taken away by an idea, and it's no longer about her. It's about what she looks like.
Right.
And that's
video killed the radio star.
It's the problem. Yeah. I don't give a shit. Her songs were better when
Rolling Stones
hers.
Couldn't get anywhere now because they're all fucking ugly as shit.
Oh, my God. Yeah, and now when you listen to their songs, like I remember they came back in like the early aughts, and they were like talking about chicks and stuff, and it's like, I don't think you should call a 50-year-old. If you're going for chicks, who I imagine to be younger women, slow down.
Women are still fucking Mick Jagger. He's like 80 years old or some shit.
Anyway,
and he's still having kids.
Anyways,
so
we got Philbin.
They take Winslow off to some room backstage, and Philbin's like, "Hey,
yeah, I didn't get." It looked like it was his own backstage area for Winslow.
I don't know. I thought it was like a trailer park. I didn't know what the fuck it was.
I was so confused by this whole spot. But
and he's like, "Hey, there, you got any demos? This is some good shit."
Yeah,
like the cocaine of music. It's some good shit.
He was very because he's used to radios, you know, and so he's like, "I need the single." And he's like, single? No. This is a whole cantata.
Right.
Cantata.
And it's all in my head.
Yeah. Well, it's not completely in his head. He's got fucking
5,000 pages.
Yeah.
It's like a dictionary.
Yeah. And he's like, oh, no. Don't give me all this shit. Look, Swan loves your shit. We just need we need the upbeats, the upbeat numbers. We just need a couple songs. And he's like, well, I don't know. I mean, I guess if you want to give it to him, he's like, great. The Juicy Fruits, they're going to take this shit to the moon.
And he just loses his shit and like pins fucking Philbin up against the wall. Only I sing Faust.
He fucking put him through that wall. Did you see that?
Yeah.
Philbin's way too heavy. So, of course, if you push him all that weight, no, it's taking a
while. So this whole cantata is based on the Faust story. About, of course, the guy who sold
his... Kinjata?
Kinjata.
Of course.
Who stole the soul of the devil for knowledge. So, you know, we all know Faust.
Yeah.
And so he's like, hey, buddy, whatever you say, just let me see that music there, that dictionary full of music.
Yeah.
And I'll get back to you. Swan will get back to you. He's like, well, sure, okay.
And we just kind of fade to black, and then we open back up, and we got this nice windy day. We get a, you know, font that tells us it's one whole month later. And Winslow's storming the gates. He's going straight to
Death Records.
To Death Records. And this is where you see the first weird imposed Death Record. Right.
But he's still chill. He still trusts Swan. He's just like, I just wonder why he hasn't got a hold of me. You know?
Yeah.
So he goes in, and the secretary, she's got this list of people that can be seen. It's got fucking Bette Midler, Alice Cooper, all these people.
Oh, everybody that's big. Dick Clark was on there.
Except for Winslow Leach. And she's like, sorry.
He was on the list.
Oh, was he?
And then she pulls it up.
That's right.
And it says, get this fucker out of here.
Right.
Yeah.
So she's like, beat it, loser. He's like, wait, what?
Yeah.
And my music.
Just so happens as he gets outside, by the way, it's daytime right now. Right. It's like 12, it's probably 10 a.m. Winslow's the type of guy who probably gets there pretty early, before lunch. And he gets outside and he sees Swan get into a taxi, I believe it was.
No, Swan is like in a Rolls Royce.
Okay.
He like pulls out from like the garage, the parking garage.
Okay, but he sees him.
Yes.
And so he gets into a taxi himself and he's like, follow that Rolls Royce. Which I wonder if that actually works, if a driver would be like, yeah, I'll do that. In the movies, it happens all the time.
Well, it worked in this, well, that's probably because we're in a movie. And we go to Swan's compound. He's got the gated community. He's got the guy, like, he's got the middle-aged couple with machine guns, making sure nobody gets on this gated community.
Yeah.
Antifa is fucking out of control.
Winslow breaks in without a problem. You see, the thing is, he only has like 2-foot walls. So even someone who is unathletic and has no agility to, you know, to speak of, like Winslow, is able to just hop over that little stone wall, and he's just walking right up the mansion. I'm just gonna ease in some of this beautiful music. I loved it. It's just a quick little piece here.
Never thought I'd get to meet the devil. Never thought I'd meet him face to face. Heard he always worked the dome, that he seldom rode or used a phone. So I walked right up to meet him at his place.
Very interesting, a little song about meeting the devil.
Kind of a back to foreshadow.
I mean, that was what the whole Foss piece was supposed to be about, but
right.
Kind of hitting the
so Swan, he has like a biker gang of security, and they...
Yeah, it's like the greasers.
Not very good, because he sneaks right in.
Well, I mean, yeah, that's true. They have no guards at the main mansion doors. They have some guards, like,
gate, yeah.
Yeah, somewhere else and everything.
And he sees there's this big line of women, and they're all, like, singing his song, but awful, of course, because they just want to be stars. They don't care about, like, the music.
It's true. They just want their face on the screens. They want
one sounds like Betty Boop. It's really annoying.
Tits on TV. It's all that matters to them.
And then he hears one voice
out
of that thing that sounds beautiful.
The ear on this man, he has the ability to just silence everything else and hear this one woman.
And he's like, you're almost as good as me when I sing it.
Yeah.
And he's like, what's your name? And she didn't even tell him his name, but she's just like, they have a nice little meet cute. And she's like, well, I'm up next, so you wait. He's like he's gonna go in with her. And they're like, hey, this ain't a sausage party here, pal.
Yeah.
Get the fuck out.
It's revealed that Philbin's name, or not Philbin, but Winslow's name is not on the sheet music or, you know, the lyrics or whatever they're singing off of, but Philbin's name's on there, or Swan's name's on there probably. So it's a whole thing, and they're like, I got to get in there. I gotta tell them, like, hey, this is my music.
Open the door, the old casting couch.
Oh,
got Winslow. Greasy fat body on top of this woman.
You said Winslow. Philbin.
Oh, Philbin, you're
right. Yeah, he had the heart boxers that were just super saggy, the white heart boxers. He's got tube socks over the kneecaps.
My God.
So
tube
you know socks. Nothing good's happening here.
Oh, nothing
In
good.
Fact, we're seeing his rear end, and it's blocking the woman that they have pinned down in front of him that I guess R is happening. It's a polite way of saying.
This is a... Not a visual medium, Griff.
Yeah,
so,
no.
Yeah,
everyone knows what we're talking about.
R. Hard R.
Hard.
And
that's a different thing.
the lady we saw, the beautiful singer.
Yep.
She's like, I ain't doing this, all right? I'm a singer. Fuck this shit. I'm in it for the music. I'm not sleeping with this fat, greasy pig.
They don't even get the first button off her blouse. Actually, they do get the first button off. So, but she's got like 45 buttons, so it doesn't matter. So she comes storming back out. Just so happened that Winslow, who is told to beat it, did a little whoopsie doodle, went down like 5 stairs, and then just swooped back around and was walking towards the door as, you know, Phoenix here is running out. And so he's like, what happened in there? What's going on? She's like, I don't want it that way.
Right.
I want to sing. They want to make me sing.
Okay.
I don't know.
So we cut to Swan's sex palace.
Ooh.
Classic 70s fuck bed. Circular waterbed. Mirrors everywhere. It's beautiful.
Yeah. Oh, it's beautiful.
And we learned that Swan likes to watch. He gets cameras everywhere.
This looked like a scene out of a Bruce Lee movie for me.
Because you
had all kinds of weird hairdos. You had voiceover happening, and it sounded like they were trying to do some bad, like, dubbing. Like the woman with the crazy cool hair that seemed to be like the madame in there. She's like, oh, Swan's watching this right now, girl. You need to come down here because this is what Swan likes. Let's slip a nip here. Let's get some talent hanging out of you.
So Swan, he's watching it. And they're just getting down to, you know.
There's one person in there. And this whole fleet, we recognize a face in a wig, I think, that was supposed to be Phoenix, right?
I think so.
And she's like macking on somebody, but we never see the front.
Carpet munching.
Yep.
And We learn, I guess, did the security guys come in? Because Swan, like, I think he notifies them.
No, Swan comes in, and he gets the fog machines going. There's a nice green light. Again, where's
laser
the,
show.
Why is the Batman and Robin light everywhere now?
It's great.
It's just when you notice it, it's everywhere.
Right.
So he comes in, and this is why I thought he was a woman. Is this was the scene. He's wearing like this, again, this takes me back to the Bruce Lee setting. He's wearing like a Japanese silk robe type thing, or pajamas.
Okay.
It was a two-piecer. Yeah. So it was like a button-up shirt, and then, so he comes in, and immediately everyone's like, Swan! And then we see the back of the head that we've been looking at, and a nice long dress, very, very tame dress, by the way. Turn around, and it's fucking Winslow.
Right. He's got to do what he's got to do.
Somehow snuck in there. Don't know how he got in there.
And then Swan just goes, get this fag out of here.
Get this fag out.
So,
hard F.
Yeah, you can do it in 74.
Yeah.
And so the greasers come in and drag his ass out. And then they just beat the fuck out of him. Off camera. We don't see it. We just see the aftermath. He's outside. Two, I want to point out, black cops.
Yep.
Roll up on him. It's like, hey, what are you doing here? What are you loitering? He's like, I got this shit kicked out of me, and I just want my music back. And like, you sound like you're high.
Yeah, you know, Swan called us and he told us you were getting into some real kinky shit, and we know what kinky people like. And it just so happens that Swan Winslow has
he still dressed as a woman, so they're thinking like he's a freak.
Yeah, he's one of those sexual perverts.
Right.
And back in 70, you couldn't be a sexual pervert, right?
Good. Not out in the open, you could.
Not out in the open, okay. So they check his purse because he had a purse on him.
Right.
Because he was pretending to be a woman.
Right.
And, of course, what he's got in there? Some of that good shit.
Yeah, real good shit. We're talking about some H, some heroin, some horse.
And it was way too much, so they figure he's a drug dealer.
Right.
Way too much.
And it's like, you're going to prison, motherfucker.
So
you get the scene, judge is like, 20 years to life.
And it was a hilariously large gavel. Yeah. Did you notice that? Like, they're doing all kinds of fun, the Lord of the Rings forced perspective. So right. The judge looks tiny. The podium looks fucking huge that he sits. Not podium, but whatever the thing is that he sits.
About.
Vestibule? That sounds like a thing.
No, that's like the church.
Oh, that's church?
Podium's fine.
Okay.
And
I like this. The much like Boogaloo Industries. Wait. Not Boogaloo. What was BIM stuff? Was it Boogaloo?
I thought it was Boogaloo.
I think it is Boogaloo. Yeah. Wow. Golan Globus loved the word Boogaloo.
They invented it.
They probably, well, they did. We know that for certain.
Yeah.
But taking yeah, just like back. Just like in Boogaloo, damn you. Just like in Boogaloo, lost my train of thought. Just like in Boogaloo Industries, where they had like control of everything in society. They had the police. They had their own like military. They had their own politicians. Death Records has control over a prison.
This is why I'm against
private prison. Yeah. I'm glad we're going the same way, man.
Right.
So they, instead of sentencing them to, you know, a normal state penitentiary or whatever, they send them to their very own Sing Song prisons.
No, this is a real prison, Griff. Sing Sing.
Oh, it's Sing Sing.
Yeah. This is like, no, this is a legitimate prison.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And, but they own it now.
They own
it. Apparently it was on the market. Good investment?
Well, come on. We're talking about privatizing. This is what you got to do.
So they bring him in front of the warden, and this isn't just some country club prison. You got to earn your keep here.
Yeah.
And they're like, first, because we got we got to get you the hydrochloroquine and all these shakes. We got to make sure you're all right. Oh, by the way, we're also going to rip your teeth out.
Well, Murray, teeth are the number one source of infection.
It's true.
So if you remove the teeth, No chance of infection whatsoever.
And Winslow, he's already doesn't have much of the looks. He's like, I got to keep my teeth.
Yeah.
So he's just like, I'm innocent. He's like, who here is innocent? And of course, everybody raises their hand. And they're like, yeah, that's what I thought. So they just yank his fucking, you don't see that, but he yanks his teeth out, and they give him a nice, beautiful silver grill.
Oh, yeah.
It. Way before all the rappers were doing it.
It's true.
Fucking Winslow was doing
so
it.
So, again, we cut to 6 months later.
6 months later, hard labor. They're working on the tiddlywinks.
yes, they are. Oh, man, they're working the hard line. And we're slowly creeping up. We're just going down the assembly line. And we see this milkman in the background. And
it's not Paul Lynde as a trucker.
It's not Paul Lynde as a trucker, but I do want to point out that he is the third man in the AEW's Butcher and the Blade ensemble.
The Milkman? Blade, the Milkman?
The Milkman. He's the manager of them, so you probably recognize him from that. But I got to say, Winslow is looking fucking great here, because as we get closer to him, you see him, and he looks like a man who just has 100% been destroyed. He does that, like, within a second. He gives you that look. I loved it.
Well, what destroys him, one of the cops has a little transistor radio, and it's like, the Juicy Fruits with their latest hit, Faust, or whatever, and that just makes him snap.
Oh, my God.
He's like, I was, past 6 months, I was just doing my time,
yep,
but fuck this shit, and he just loses his shit. Attacks the fucking cop.
I like that the cop waited for him to do a flip. This is where the Macho Wrestling started right here, Murray. I'm sorry that it connected so
and who
well.
Who knew how easy it was to get out of prison? He just jumps where the tiddlywink
the shipping, shipping box. It's just like you see on an airplane with the fucking luggage conveyor belt. He just jumps at a box, jumps on that, flips right out.
And he immediately falls as soon as the truck goes outside the gate. He falls out.
Yeah, and it just happens to dump him out at Death Records. Right. Like, this is very convenient. If you're gonna have businesses, might as well keep them close together. So Sing Sing, which looked like it was on a fucking Batman Island, you know, cliffside, is apparently right next door to Death Records.
Right. Well, they own everything.
You know, that's a good
point. And he's like, I'm going to get the Masters and destroy them. There's no way the Juicy Fruits are going to be known as singing Faust.
Yeah.
So I bust in, and he's like, ding, 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 ding. Like,
that implies that there's some sneaking happening here. This man is like a fucking, you know when a little critter gets in your house, a bird, and it starts freaking the fuck out and your animals are going crazy? We're in panic mode. My heart is racing at this point. Okay. So he's flying around Death Records, happens to stumble into the master room.
Yeah.
And realize he's finding all the records and everything.
Rifling through those records, looking like a young Griff.
I do go through pretty quick. I don't want to, you know, get caught. I guess that's a sign that I'm doing something wrong. I don't want to get caught.
Right. I'm going to rip your fucking teeth out and give you so much teeth. Does he get the Masters?
So what happens is that he starts fiddling around. He doesn't know what to do. He's never worked with this kind of machinery.
Right.
He gets like his sleeve caught as he's like...
Well, it's like where it presses the vinyl.
Yeah, where it's pressing the vinyl. So he ends up getting like his sleeve caught on the machinery.
Well, he gets distracted by a cop. A security guard comes out. It's like, stop. And then
he's
like, and he's like, what? And he throws his hand out and it catches on that thing.
Yeah.
Starts up the machine.
And of course, with the other hand, he starts it up and, you know, yakety sax starts up. And he just like falls over into the fucking machine.
He gets shot, I thought. I thought he got shot and that's why he fell over.
That explains the bleeding. Yeah. He got shot. You're right.
And his head first, it's most like the Toxic Avenger, his head goes right into it.
Yep.
And the press just crushes his head and burns him.
I'm thinking it crushes the
fucking
head.
Those are some great fucking glasses because those didn't get broken, though.
They did not. Those are some good glasses. You
were
right
about
that.
Half of his face got horribly scarred and burned.
Whew. But we see him. He manages. The cop apparently disappeared. Maybe this is when cops actually were like, oh, shit, I just shot somebody. Instead of like, I'm going to go strangle him now. Right. The cop is like, I got to go. So he disappears.
Drops a gun, plants a gun on him and leaves.
Yeah. And he drops the gun.
He's the one that goes ding, 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 ding. Tippy toes out.
So, yeah, our boy Winslow is able to get out of there. We see he's fucked up. Glasses still kind of together, but, you know, with a little tape, 100% fine. But he's bleeding all over that milkman uniform. He's fucking, his face is horribly scarred. His eye, you know, just blood all over his eye.
Stumbles into the East River.
He hears like there's backup coming. They got the helicopters out and everything. Stumbles into the East River.
And then he's dead. He's got to be. Nobody can survive that.
And we're actually hearing the radio chatter. Well, he's probably dead now. He's in the East River. And you know what we did to the East River? We just polluted the fuck out of it. And he's got all these open wounds. But that water's going to kill him.
Or is he? Cut to the Paradise. They're just getting ready for that opening night.
Yep.
Got all the rehearsals going on for the Juicy Fruits. And we're getting a point of view shot from this character. He's breathing like Darth Vader.
Yep.
We're like, okay, that's Winslow, obviously.
It's got to be Winslow. We're doing a very cool thing where this is all done in like one shot. I don't think there's any cutaways here. And we're slowly like profiling the building. We're seeing like how the backstage works and everything. Guards are freaking out because he's so disfigured. They're just like, I want nothing to do with you, buddy. I ain't got no money. I'm not buying you any booze. I know that's what you're going to buy. You're not going to get a sandwich. You're going to go get booze. So, like, the guards are just fucking running away from him.
Right.
Oh, there's only the two guards. His guards are awful.
They are.
They really are.
They're too busy, like, raping women. And
they really are. Yeah. And getting high and greasing their hair.
But it's good for Winslow.
It is good. So
he stumbles into, like, a costume room.
Yep.
And then he's like, this is perfect. Grabs the fucking leather. Grabs the fucking owl mask kind of thing.
Yeah, it's like a hawk. Kind of got a beak thing.
I don't
going
know. It's
a
very interesting look. I like
it. It's really cool. I really like it.
And he just stumbles away.
Yeah, we just kind of follow him. We don't get to really see what he's up to because the camera, as it's following him, we see they're auditioning. They're using, again, they have the music, but they don't know what style to really do with it. Like, we heard the Juicy Fruits do one of the songs in their old, like, doo-wop-y style. Yeah. That's what we heard on the little radio.
This is a band called the Beach Bums.
Yes. Same three guys.
And they're doing the Beach Boys rendition, the surf version of this song.
And so this is where we're going to get our first Alfred Hitchcock-style split screen. And apparently our boy Winslow has been building bombs. Or there just happened to be a bomb there. And it's a
it's like the old like dynamite.
I was gonna say it's a cartoon bomb because it's the six sticks of red dynamite with a clock on it and a couple of wires to say, yeah, you know what's going on,
right?
You know it, wink, Wile E. Coyote in the background.
Yeah. Remember, this is the '70s, so it's really a clock. Now it would be like a red like LED readout.
Yeah.
Then he puts it in this prop car they have for their scene. And then then he goes ding 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 ding, ding, ding. Goes
this
away.
This is where we get some of those.
And he's
dings.
Just doing like a Family Opera. He's like lurking in like the catwalks above.
He's finding a good place to spot because he wants to see the carnage. That's what this is all about. He needs to see.
Swan is like in his office, just kind of watching.
He's on his balcony, man.
Oh, he is.
On his balcony right now. Yep. He's got this sweet ass balcony where it's like they somehow reflect all light in front of him. Because he's always lurking in that shadow, and whenever he wants to emerge, he just steps forward, but it's rare that he does.
So what's going on with these beachmen? One of the guys is like high on drugs or something. He's like, I can't perform.
There's a lot happening right now, because you got all the girls in their bikinis, and they're dancing. The guys are like studying the lines.
And the girls are like on the carts, like, oh my God, these hot chicks are going to get killed.
Yeah.
And then there's this guy, he was like, I can't do it. I got the diarrhea. I ate at Vinny's earlier today, man. Don't eat the fucking...
Don't eat it? Not before a rehearsal, but definitely eat it. Yeah. Philbin's like, what the fuck are you talking about? Vinny's is the best. That's right. The guy was trying to shit on it.
He's like, here, take some of this. He's just putting pills in his mouth.
This movie's big on pills.
Right.
But all fucking record industry type movies are.
And just as fucking Philbin's about to fucking bitch slap this guy, the bomb goes off.
Oh, Jesus.
And fucking, in Swan's defense, nothing flusters this guy.
Dude.
He's always got another plan.
And this is where I start to see that Swan apparently has a camera in his forehead or something. He's wearing Google glasses. Because he reviews this scene later, and it follows his vision, and we see that he looks up and sees something.
You're right, he has Google glasses.
Yeah, he's got Google glasses. Those are the prototypes.
Yeah, right. Oh, he invested heavily in Google.
Oh my God.
And yeah, you're right. He's like, interesting. Like, not totally chill. Doesn't even. There's this madman who just blew up. He's just like, I could work him into this.
I suppose we figure it out later. I mean, we know that he's kind of immortal. So yeah, Swan does head back to his secret studios to review that footage, just like I mentioned.
So he's got the little thing. He pulls the candelabra to the side. And the door opens.
I love it.
About to go in, fucking
he gets in there.
He's again there?
Because he watches it, and he sees, and of course, he's already got the fucking CSI technology. And it zooms in, perfectly clear, 1080p. They didn't even have that shit back then, but Swan had it.
He had it.
So he gets a close-up. He sees the fucking cool-ass hawk mask that he's wearing. He sees him lurking there, and he recognizes in the mask it has one kind of mirrored lens over the right eye, and then the left eye is exposed, but he blacked it out. And then those teeth, which he put black makeup on too.
He's got
lipstick.
Silver teeth. Yeah, he's got black lipstick.
Yeah. And so he reviews it, and he's like, "Ah, yes, my old friend." So he gets ready to leave, and then.
Yeah, then Winslow shows up, the Phantom. He puts a knife to his neck. "You motherfucker!" And he's like, "Well, Winslow, it's nice to see you again.
What was that voice I heard there? What's wrong with you? Show me your face."
Yeah, because his voice is really fucked up. He can barely understand. He's got like a voice. He's got a little like fucking radio thing.
He didn't have it yet.
He didn't?
No, because that's what Swan gives him.
So he couldn't understand him, and he's just like, I could still make you a star?
Yeah.
I love the look. The look is great.
You're going to let some teeth being ripped out and your voice getting all fucked up and you're getting shot. You're going to let that stop you from being a fucking star?
And then he's conflicted because he's like, holy shit, this guy ruined my life, but he's offering me this. He just runs away. He's just like, I got to think about
it. Yeah, it's too much. It's too much. I got to think about it. I got to go in like a dark corner, probably poop myself and really think about this.
So while that's going on, our girl Phoenix from early, I guess she's like, well, I'm going to give him another shot. I almost got raped last time.
No.
I want to be famous so badly, I'm going to try it this time.
Yeah.
She got nowhere in the past 6 months. So she's just like, she's auditioning again. And Philbin was like, you again? They ain't going to suck my dick. And she's like, look, I just want
to
sing.
I'm here to sing. We don't want singers. We want screamers. Are you going to scream? She's like, I'm not screaming for shit. So she gets ready to walk off, and then you hear Philbin, who I thought this came later, but apparently it's right now. Or not Philbin, but Swan. He's like, no, let her sing because a hand touched him on his shoulder. Wonder what that could be.
She sings, and it's the most beautiful, beautiful voice you ever heard. Some of the worst white girl dancing you've ever seen.
Oh, my God.
And it's painful, and you're embarrassed for her. And fucking Winslow's like, he's like, he's getting into it, and yeah. Like Swan totally chill. She's good, isn't she?
Who are you talking to, Swan? Camera pans up. Apparently Winslow came back,
yeah,
and
Winslow's
he's like
back. He's
yeah.
back in. He's like, I want her voice.
Ooh.
I'm like, holy shit.
What do you mean you want her voice there, bud?
He's, I don't know.
So Swan is like, okay, look, we gotta get you right in music, recording music. We gotta get you back in shape. We need to get you a voice again. So let me take you to my sweet fucking demo lab.
This is actually a real functioning thing. This wasn't made.
That's awesome. It already looks fucking cool. That's even cooler that it's functional.
Right. It's like it's somewhere in Canada right now.
Okay.
And yeah, so it's like this crazy fucking synth family opera. It's like there's keyboards everywhere.
Yeah, it's beautiful. And wires crisscrossing all over the place.
And then, like you pointed out, he gave him this little voice box thing. And he's working on the modulation, the auto-tuning that voice perfectly.
Yep. For the singing. He's not going to get that beautiful voice to talk. But to sing with all the end production, out production, if you will, they're going to make it sound just like he did when, he was an up-and-coming star. So
he gets that beautiful auto-tuned voice. And Swan's like, look, baby, you got to finish that cantata.
Yeah,
we're
going to
have Phoenix. She's going to sing it. It's going to be amazing. But first, we gotta iron out some shit. I have this. It's a little contract. You don't need to, like, read it. It's just 5,000 pages, like a telephone book. He flops down. He's like, I had my man Mitch McConnell go over it.
Yep.
He says it's solid. You don't need to read it. You just need to sign it. And we're going to do this. The Faust is going to happen.
And so we do this cool, it's almost like another cartoon or silent film effect, where Winslow reads a line, and then it cuts to like a black and white screen with like this beautiful calligraphy, and then like the sides are kind of like varying shadows and stuff, and it's quivering. It was cool. But he's like, all entries that weren't included are not excluded. What the fuck does that mean? And he's like, oh, that just means you're safer if you sign this deal. That's for your safety. And he winks. Everything is for his safety, clearly.
Right. So he's just like, wow, this doesn't sound right. Don't worry about it. Just sign it.
Yeah, I mean, we can just let you go right back out to society, you know, with your teeth and your mask, and you can go get some hot dogs, hide your fills out front. You can go hang out with him.
And he's just like, okay, I'll sign it.
what else do I have to lose, well, you know?
He pulls out like a feather. He's like, or like, no, he had it was a pen. Ink
yeah.
pen. And he pokes his finger.
It's like, yeah, goes, yeah, no, ink doesn't work here.
Ink, that's so 1973. We're 74, baby. Sign it with blood. And he's like, okay. And he signs Winslow Leach in his own blood.
Swamp pulls out a stamp. He's got his own stamp, and he rubs his blood in it and just stamps down his name. That was a good touch.
So he's got them. They're in business forever.
So we get a nice song. We get to start playing in the background. Wynn's got a candle up on his piano.
To let you know how time's passing. Yep. He's got this gigantic Bed Bath & Beyond. It smells like Gwyneth Paltrow's vagina candle.
That's right.
And he's just because it gets him in the mood. The scent of Gwyneth Paltrow's vagina gets him in the mood to write. And he's just working, slave. We get the old school where you see like the days on the calendar,
yep,
like
ripping
go
away,
by.
Yeah. Tear away, like a word of the day kind of calendar.
Swan just cabins in. How's it going? And he's like, how's this? Tasty.
Oh my goodness. So he actually takes a couple of sheets with him. It's not done yet, but he takes some of the sheets because he wants to. Again, as we talked about with the juicy fruits and the beach bombs, he's trying to find what sound to use for this music. It's beautiful, right. But he needs to get that right sound. Is it rock? Is it surf rock? Is it pop rock? Is it paparazzi rock?
I don't know. He had a fucking great desk. It was like a gold record. He's right in the middle of it.
It was so cool. That was fucking awesome. And then he's got all these people around him auditioning with spotlights in each spot. And so they have like, you know, some soul singers there doing their version.
Gospel singers.
They got Gigi Allen there, of course.
Shits on that beautiful gold table.
Is there an episode where we don't mention Gigi Allen?
We don't mention him enough. And I would have picked him to sing Faust. I don't know what he was thinking. I was like, that's the guy?
But just like as we saw Swan with those knobs, he knows how to he's like, okay, that is good. I like that there's an edge there. That's the edge I want. But we need to tone it down a little bit.
No, he's like, we need something heavy.
Yeah, well, no, I mean we need to tone down the shitting. Oh, we just need him not to shit. Good sound, bad smell.
Right. He's just like, because Philbin's like, well, I thought you were going to have that Phoenix broad. It's like, no, 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 no. She's going in the backup. We need something heavy.
Yeah. This is the apples comparison to, Elfie and Annie. I can't remember her name. That's no one cares about that love bullshit. No one likes those beautiful singing ballads and everything. No, we're not doing that. I mean, Axl Rose is another 20 years, 15, 10 years out, 80 something.
About 15, yeah.
15. Like Axl Rose is 15 years out. I've seen the future. It's not going to work until then.
So it's like, you know what we need? We need some beef.
And the spotlight turns on as he yells out beef. Where is the beef? Here's the beef.
And the beef apparently looks like a young David Hasselhoff.
He's got that bushy, curly hair.
Hairless chest. And very flamboyant. I'll just use that word, flamboyant.
Very flamboyant.
You could say swishy. You could say other words. I'm going to say flamboyant.
I like it.
But like a butch kind of swishiness. I don't know what was going on with beef.
Yeah, it was.
Because it's a very much a very cliche, like gay guy, like lispy voice.
Yes.
And he had very glam look to him.
Yes.
But he was called himself Beef.
Yes.
And he was a rocker.
It's very interesting. I love what this movie does. And you know what? Beef is awesome. He is amazing in this. Like he's a heel through and through. He really gets under your skin.
And
I love
so the future is beef, people. And so we just go back to Winslow. The candle's halfway down. He's just slaving away. He's like, I'll have it ready for Friday. Friday is when the paradise opens.
Yep. And sure enough, Swan's out there just like our president. Vaccine's ready tomorrow. He's been saying that since February.
Well, much like our president, he does have a presser at an airport.
He really did.
They fly in and like you cannot take pictures of Swan.
Yep.
And he's just like,
this is not a gathering. What does he call it? A privacy protest or something? A peaceful protest. Privacy protest.
So he's like, he's announcing this the rock version of Faust that's never been done before. It's been recorded live at the Paradise.
Mr. Swan, are you going to have the Beach Bum sing it? Or maybe like the Juicy Fruits?
No, they're so last year. we're going to have, and it's really dramatic. We see these guys wheel out this casket.
Oh, yeah, I thought Undertaker just had a match the recent week.
Undertaker! And he's like, we're going to give you a big old slab of beef! And then the casket opens, and yes! And then he goes, or something like that.
They painted his face like silvery gray, like he was going to a Raiders game or something.
Maybe he was.
Had a fucking like white streak in his hair, and then he was spray painted silver, and then it was so bizarre. Everything about beef is bizarre and wonderful. Again, you watch this movie, and the first time you're like, you can't focus on what you hear because you're like, what am I seeing? And then you do the reverse. What am I hearing? What am I seeing? It's amazing. It's so good.
So we cut back to Winslow slaving away. Swan's checking in.
Yep.
He's like waking up. He's just like, oh my God. And he's like, is it going to be ready by Friday? It'll be ready. He's got a suitcase full of pills. He's like, he's feeding them to fucking Winslow.
Yeah, Winslow has lost track of all time and space. I mean, he's been holed up in the studio, so it's like, of course he did. But yeah, he's like, you look a little hungry, so let's go ahead. And he's open up, he's grabbing the zoomies and the zippies and the good coke and very, very.
It's all good shit.
It's all good shit. He grabs the red pill too. He's like, I'm gonna
and
get
he's
this
like,
guy.
I'll take what you've gotten so far. It's like, I'll be ready by tomorrow. It's like, all right, I'll take this. He walks out. He goes, get the bricks ready.
Oh shit! Oh, we're going into a little Pink Floyd here. He's gonna build the wall, huh?
Yes.
Nice
allusion to Edgar Allan Poe. Well, with stealing somebody up in a room. But that, yep. Not yet, because he hasn't finished.
Swanga heads back to his balcony where he's going to watch over the rehearsal because they're getting beef ready. You know, they're getting it all nice and laid out. They're
marinating that beef.
They're marinating it, massaging it like it's Wagyu or something.
And he's trying his damnedest. But he's like, look, honey, I can't sing falsetto. And they're like,
If you want someone to sing falsetto, you get one of these bitches to sing it.
And Swan, nothing phases this guy. He's just like, hey, baby, make it your own. Do it your own way.
Well, no, he's like, what do you got planned for me? Let's hear you do it your way. And so fucking beef. What is he wearing at this point? Do you remember what he was wearing?
It was always like a jacket with no shirt and like some like gold pants or something like that.
I remember. It looked like I'm sorry to do this again. It looked like one of Cody's outfits because he had like leopard print crotch. And then it was like the rest of it was a different color. But then he had this belt buckle.
Giant wrestling belt buckle, yeah.
No, Murray, I'm sorry. I'm not going to allow you to do this. This belt buckle was fucking amazing. It was one of those, like, plastic encased. It was a little snake.
I did not see that. There was a snake in there?
It was about,
a live snake?
It was bigger than an index card. It was bigger than a postcard. Okay, let's say it was postcard size, but it was a 3D belt because there was a fuck. It wasn't live. It was not a case. It was one where you preserve it in. So he's got this fucking 4x6-inch snake belt thing on.
Most people just have a snake skin belt. He has a fucking snake belt.
And then he's got 5-inch platform clogs on.
Of course.
And he's dancing around, singing a song the way he
wants
to see it.
Playing guitar, he's doing it all.
He doesn't have the guitar yet. He's just singing. And then he tries to like lean back, falls over, and this is where Swan is just like, I love it. This is great. Do whatever you want, baby. Make it your own.
He's like, I got to go check in on a little Winslow. So he goes back to that room. It's completed. But he's passed out. He's exhausted from all this.
Yeah, he wrote out the end in very thick letters.
Right. So he takes it, got the big nice stack, walks out, seal him up. We don't need him anymore. So they start going to work on that wall, putting another brick in that wall.
And, of course, Wins wakes up a short minute later. Swan! Well, we got other things to look into, like Beef's locker room. Beef locker.
Dressing room. And, yeah, he's getting ready for the big opening night. He's doing a little of the booger sugar.
Booger sugar? Oh, yeah. Yes, I see.
And he's just like, I got a shower before. He's got nice sweaty in that rehearsal.
He's being a total bitch.
Well, he is being a diva. He's a star now.
Because you hear this fucking horrible shriek, the shriek that we cut away from, and he goes over to Philbin. At this point, he is wearing deer antlers as a belt. Yes. Multiple. Not just in the front. He's got them like all the way around him. Every outfit Beef is wearing.
My favorite outfit comes later. Yeah. You know what it is, yeah.
Oh, okay.
But, yeah, he's got the antlers, you're right.
So, and the director is like, let's make sure to really emphasize this. He is bumping uglies with Philbin because Philbin's like, you're hearing things. He's like, no, this place is fucking haunted as
look,
shit.
Honey.
Winslow
this
died here.
This place is haunted.
Thank you, Murray.
I don't and like it.
That is exactly how he said it.
He's just like, I just leave. I got to take a shower. And I got to do some coke. So yeah. He fucking does a couple pumps of coke.
He realizes he's being watched on a camera.
Well, there's everywhere. Yeah.
They're giant cameras everywhere. And they're always making that noise. Because when they turn and everything, right. They're very
so he
loud.
He jumps in the shower. He's soaping up.
And he starts singing the song. Right. You always sound so good in the shower, so you sing there.
Right. And then we get, and this is where we get the psycho, Hitchcock psycho reference, where he's showering, and we see like the point of view of the killer, and he's coming up.
Yeah.
And he's holding, we see it's Winslow with a knife.
Yeah.
But he just uses it to cut the shower curtain. And then he just grabs a plunger and shoves it in Beef's face.
Yeah. He's not ready to, oh, goodness gracious. He's not ready to kill him yet. He just says, hey, man.
Well, this guy's innocent. He's just singing.
Right.
But he's like, you can't sing that song. Nobody sings that song but me or Phoenix.
You try, you die. That was the warning.
And say, these songs are for Phoenix. So outside, Philbin, he's looking for some jailbait. He's like, hey.
I have to imagine. I mean, he was saying he was looking, making sure everyone had their tickets in order, you know, that whole thing. But he was doing a lot of frisking. Steven Seagal frisking, you know.
Yeah, you got to go to the doctor. You got breast cancer.
Of course, the doctor is in the dressing room over here.
And what's going on? Coming down the fire escape is Beef in my favorite outfit. He's wearing a Santa Claus jacko. And he's got all his bags packed. And he's like, look, honey, I'm out of here. I almost got killed. He's like, you're going to fucking sing.
Like, what do you mean you almost got killed? You're just make-believing. You know, it's all that speed, baby.
You've been doing speed. He's like, well, I did a little. And then he's like, get your fucking ass back up there. You're doing the fucking show.
I'm surprised. I didn't think Philbin. This is why Philbin gets the bucks he does. Because right. He fucking got him back in there.
Right.
And I believe at this point, Beef is always like painting a little something on his face. I didn't know if he had the four-leaf clover or
I
if
don't
he.
No,
had...
it was different every scene.
It's crazy. So much to look for. All right. These little details. It's so wonderful.
So then the show must go on, and it does. And it's amazing, man. It's like a fucking Alice Cooper show.
Yeah. We don't know what happened with that altercation because it just cuts away. So
yeah.
did Philbin really get him back in there?
Yeah.
Or did Beef? Fucking leap.
I don't know.
Building up tension.
Oh, sorry.
You're just agreeing. Yeah, it goes back. Of course. That's right, Griff. This is the movie.
I wouldn't have fucking Philbin threatened my life.
Dude, yeah. He's like, my mom's sick. I gotta
get
out of here.
So the opera begins, and it starts out with some like proto black metal guys. They got the corpse paint on, and they're fucking going out in the audience. They got a guitar with a knife on the fucking edge of it, and they're cutting body parts off of... audience members.
They have this awesome stage. And by the way, this is the third incarnation of the Beach Bums or the Juicy Fruits. This is the Undeads. And they're opening for Beef. Not opening. They're just kind of part of it.
Yeah, they're just opening the opera, I guess.
Yeah. And so the stage like has that normal like curve, but then there's these walkways that go out and kind of crisscross. So there's people, you know.
We're getting like flashing light, like lightning and
shit.
Oh,
yeah.
Very atmospheric.
You're getting that guar, they're cutting limbs off, blood is squirting, jizz everywhere.
There's obviously an Alice Cooper influence on this scene because they're ripping off body parts of the audience members, and then they're taking them back to this table with this like screen blocking it off, and we see these women dressed up like zombie nurses, like sewing shit up.
And we even see our dear Phoenix back there in disguise, or not in disguise, but in costume and everything.
Right.
She did manage to stay on as a backup singer.
And just as the undead finish their song, they go, here's the Beef! And the curtain goes down, and Beef looks like Frankenstein. He's got the scars, like they put the body together.
Oh, yeah. It's so cool because they put all the body parts, and then they raise it up to the rafters. And this is where we first see...
They don't do enough of this shit. And this is why kids don't listen to rock music anymore. Because
you go
they don't
to
do
rock
shit.
Music shows.
Yeah, because they don't do this shit
anymore.
More
production.
No, none of it.
I love to see more of this kind
Bring
of shit.
Bring it back, people.
I want some more Guitar Wolves out there, actually. That was a little intense. I'd see Guitar Wolf tomorrow if I could, but man, that
so,
was intense.
But we're seeing Frankenstein now, or should I say Beef Frank.
I did want to point out again, they raised, after they put all the limbs in that coffin again, esophagus.
Sarcophagus.
They raise it up to the rafters, and then they have this neon lightning bolt that blinks and meh, meh, and then they do like a whole fucking lightning effect, and then it lowers back down, and then Beef emerges as
looking like Frank. He's got the scars where like the body parts are put together.
Yeah, and he's got, you know, of course, hot pants on, and then platform red boots, and then just like a little heartbreak kid, Shawn Michaels, like he's got the fucking gloves and that little like weird chest piece he would wear.
While that's going on, we see lurking in the shadows Winslow. He's fucking pissed. He told this guy, "You're not singing this
song.
You're
not singing my song."
And so, but Beef doesn't care. The show must go on.
Oh yeah.
So he's got the guitar out. He's fucking hitting these fucking Eddie Van Halen licks.
Oh,
R.I.P. And we see fucking in the background doing her funky chicken dance.
It's bizarre how much chicken dancing there is.
And that's the last straw for Winslow. So yeah, he grabs that fucking lightning bolt neon sign, gives him the hot Beef injection. He just hurls it at Beef.
Yeah.
And it just electrocutes Beef.
And the audience loves it.
They thought he's part of the show. They love it.
Exactly. When you're seeing some fantastical shit, this is what you're coming to expect. You expect to see some crazy fucking shit like this. They already saw limbs getting cut off, so of course this is part of the show.
And then they just close the curtain. Like, you know, they're like, yeah, this is not part of the show, people.
Of course.
He's on fire, for Christ's sake. And Philbin's like, Fanny, come here. Calm that audience down. They're loving it, by the way. They're not angry.
They're ready for. They're like, wait, we're like 2 minutes into this, and we're going to encore already. Like, this is excessive. But you know, they're clapping. Let's get it back on. We haven't seen the fucking lights come up. We know you're doing an encore.
Right. So they sent Phoenix out, and she cools him down with a nice little ballad.
Yep. Because if they don't send Phoenix out, they know that Winslow's behind it. Right. Again, Swan somehow noticed him. So they're like, okay, here's what it is. We got to fucking get her out there, because that'll calm Winslow down, and then I can go figure out where he's at or whatever.
And it does work, because Winslow, he's up in the rafters. He's got the spotlight right on her. He's doing the lighting.
Yeah, he goes over and gets the lighting
and
right.
This audience loves everything.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, they just put it on stage and they'll applaud.
This is the problem with democracy too. We want to pass marijuana recreationally, but it's the fucking, you know, the crazy conservatives that are in office. They're like, no, we can't allow that, even though 70% of Michigan wanted it.
Okay.
I'm trying to say that fucking Swan is depriving us of what we want, because he's just like, no, I tell them what they want.
He's not, because he's like, okay, that's what they want now.
Only because people were getting murdered.
Well, you know, he rolls with the fucking punches, dude.
We didn't even bring it up in the top half. Our governor was almost kidnapped by a militia. Yeah,
because we're the home of crazy militia people. You know, Tim McVeigh.
And we didn't even bring it up because it's not even shocking in this day and age.
No, it's not. We expect this shit.
Exactly.
You were in their fucking area, like, neck of the woods yesterday.
I saw some people.
Did you join any militias while you were up there?
Join any? No, but
any Rorschach masks?
They are recruiting hard up there. Like, they're outside every building. Like, usually when you go to the airport, you have the religious people hitting out the flyers.
What's their incentives? What are they offering?
What are they offering? That's what I was asking them, but they didn't have anything to offer.
Is that no health care? Is that socialism?
Yes. They said that.
I don't like the way that sounds.
Yeah.
Getting back to the movie. So Swan is like, baby, you're the star, Beef. He's nothing.
Yeah, this crowd is ready to leave after hearing that song. They're like, all right, we were already jizzing ourselves when the fucking rock song was on. Then the guy blew up. Then we shit ourselves. And then she came out and sang us. We're tired. We went through a range of emotions tonight. Right. So everyone claps. They close the curtains again. They're like, all right, we're going to finish this tomorrow.
Yeah, he's like, I got the greatest idea. You're going to be Faust.
Oh my God.
And she's like, I just want to sing. It's about the music to me. For like 5 seconds, it's about the music. And then she totally sells out, because he's like, let's go home. Let's talk about this.
Let's go home. Let's talk about this. Because I want to give you what you want.
And she's like, okay, I got to go. I'll get my jacket. While she goes to get her jacket, Winslow intercepts her, takes her to the top of the building. He's like, look what this fucker did to me. You cannot trust Swan. She's like, he's an all right guy.
Yeah, I mean, They're standing at the
edge. I almost got raped in an audition six months ago, but now I'm starring in this fucking, you know, opera.
Yeah, and he already told me that I'm going to be back out here tonight, and she looks down because they're on the roof of the building, and they can see all the people, and they're chanting Phoenix. I don't know how they know her name, but they know it. Maybe Swan or Philbin announced it.
That's how great Swan is with branding. You just know it. And he's like talking with Philbin and is like our Rolls Royce. He's like, we got her. She's going to be the next star.
We don't even have to change her name. Even the name is fantastic. This is just working out great. But so back on the roof.
They're like, where is she, by the way? Go get her.
Yeah.
So one of the goons goes to get her and she immediately fucking rats out Winslow. She's like, this creep.
Yeah. She wants nothing to do with Winslow. She's like, all my artistic integrity is gone now because I got the payday. Fuck all y'all. I'm getting paid. So she runs
She's like,
out.
I already tried it the right way for 6 months. That don't work.
Yes.
So they go back to that sweet fuck palace that Swan has. He's got the fucking skylight.
Of course, the rain is pouring down. And
and we get one of the most grotesque scenes I've ever seen in a movie.
And you can't,
and I've seen Faces of Death.
You can't have a scene like this without a song like this. And I thought it was a John DeHart original, but apparently...
It was a Swan DeHart original.
Swan.
And it went straight to my heart.
Let's just get in the mood.
What shall we drink to?
Starting over.
How about new beginnings? Let's hope they never end.
Sounds good to me. Walked away from love and thought it wasn't right.
Starting over, and you feel like you're gonna. Why did I ever let you slip away?
Life. Start over, you fool. It's easy to do. Don't lay at an ending. Get a hold of you. Walk towards the future. Get out of the past. And remember the good things of life. You know that sometimes lasts.
Starting over.
And you know when you hear that, ice cubes are coming out for the nipples.
Oh, they're going straight. It's a magnet. How do they work? Fucking.
So you see.
I don't even.
So Winslow's looking through the sky. It's raining. Thankfully, it's blocking, obscuring a lot
of
Paul Williams.
They knew what they had to do.
Right.
Because we have a shot of Phoenix on her back next to.
Well, she's cradling him like a baby because he's such a little guy.
And like, he's wearing another nice pajama outfit set, right. And he's
Hugh Hefner like, yeah.
Yes, and he's got the whole front unbuttoned, and so she's sliding open to get that nipple exposed for the ice cube.
Right.
And again, the rain is blurring it, but me and Murray know we've seen this scene.
We know it.
We do.
We've done
research.
It for fuck's sake, you know.
Yeah.
Not to each other.
Yeah.
And
well, just the one time.
Winslow is just as disturbed as we are. He's like, I'm going to have to kill myself. I can't look at this guy's nipples any longer.
Yeah. And he's like, at least it's sensual right now. If fucking Boogie Slide. Wait. Boogie Slide?
I don't know what that means.
I'm the other John DeHart hit.
Oh, Shimmy Slide.
Shimmy Slide. He was like, if the Shimmy Slide starts up, I'm done. And sure enough, like a monster in the, he just, lightning crashes down. He's like, no! He's very Darth Vader-like.
Right.
And he
pulls out a knife and stabs himself in his armpit.
Nothing to do. You got to kill yourself after that.
Right, yeah.
You got to
try
yourself.
At least.
Yeah.
And apparently Swan heard that loud scream.
Yeah.
So he makes his way up to the...
We get a nice shot of him smirking. It's not close enough. It's close enough where you're not seeing the nipple just nice and erect from an ice cube, you know, being exposed to it. But it's close enough to see that smirk. Again, what's his name again, the actor?
Paul Williams.
He's so good at just the facials, man. They're so good.
Yeah.
So
you look like the Grinch when he smiles.
Yes, very much so.
And he makes his way up to the roof.
Because he knew the whole time that
he
Winslow
knew it all.
Was...
He knew that he was watching.
He knew.
Can see the guy. Winslow's not trying to hide. You can totally see this creepy fucking...
Holy shit. When Phoenix was doing her audition and she starts dancing, you remember she goes kind of off stage?
Yeah.
You see one of the goons and he's got a boner, and you see him grab the fuck out of it. I'm not kidding. I saw that the second time I was watching. Oh, my God. I was dying.
Just the little details.
I'll show it to you when we're done here. Oh, nice. My God.
Maybe we'll post
so
it on Instagram.
Maybe.
And so he's standing over. He's like, hey, you can't die. We got a contract.
This is some good shit right here. I like this.
And he's like, well, I'm going to fucking kill you. And he's like, well, you kill me, you die too.
No. He stabs him. Winslow stabs the shit out of him.
Well, I thought he explained it first, and then he's like, fuck it, and then he stabs him still.
Well, he explains that, and it's simple. You can't kill me. Or, you know, you can't die because of the contract. And right. I thought then he tried to stab him. He's like, oh, I'm sorry. I'm under contract too, baby.
Yeah, he's subcontracting with the devil. He's not even the devil, for fuck's sake. Imagine what the devil would do to somebody.
Oh, my goodness.
And, yeah, he's like, I don't die.
Yeah.
And if I do die, you die. And he tries to stab him still. He's like, I'm under contract. You can't kill me.
It can't be done.
So we get another nice of those nice, like the spinning fucking newspaper. But the old Rolling Stone magazine, which where all the lame people get their information about music. Yep. And we learn that Swan and Phoenix are going to marry.
Oh, shit.
At the Faust finale live
so
that night.
Three days have passed or something?
No, it's the next day. Then they're going to do this. That's why they knew how to print shit really fast back in those days. Rolling Stone was on top.
They were. Or Death Records has their own printing press, and they own Rolling Stones now. Which is why Faust.
It probably explains Faust. Why
Swan gets so much good publicity.
Dwayne Allman was considered the second best guitar player of all time.
What?
And so, yeah, so they're getting married. So Swan, he can't like that.
Oh, of course not. It's probably. Ugh.
So we get everyone's just like, oh my God, they're getting married. We're back to the paradise.
Yep.
Swan's walking in with Phoenix. Phoenix is coked out of her mind.
Oh my God, she is so.
And all these young girls are just like, as you would expect.
They want to fuck Swan. Yeah.
And
13-year-old girls, 38-year-old women.
This old brat. She couldn't be less than 40.
Yeah.
She was just hideous, this old hag.
Oh boy.
And she's just like, oh my God, he was my boyfriend. Like, what? What?
And she's got this.
He wouldn't fuck someone, grandma. What the fuck? You're his old lady's grandma.
We know you've just been taking too many drugs, mom. And she's like, no, seriously. And she pulls out this giant, like, baseball-sized
high school
gaudy
sweethearts.
Rocket.
Yeah.
She's like, no, we dated. We were necking all that summer. And she opens it up. And it's like a child with his wig on.
Yeah, it was crazy.
And the little girls are just like, he hasn't aged a day. But we also hear all this murmuring about how Faust. Swan is going to wear a mask to get married? Like, what the fuck was that about?
Yeah, I don't know. But what I do know is that our man Winslow finally sneaks into his private master tape area.
Yeah, which you think he would have done because he's been in the paradise. I guess this all takes place over a week. He was locked up. So this was the first chance he got to go in there. Movie checks out.
I think he wants to get his contract is what he wants to do.
Yeah.
And he stumbles upon one that says, do not open. This means you, Winslow. And he's like, I need to look at this. Apparently, his contract with the devil was put on videotape.
Yeah.
Because he puts it on the huge reel-to-reels, puts it on, he's watching. We see 20 years ago, earlier, a nice, young, fresh-faced, beautiful boy.
He had the Trump hair at this time.
Yes, he did. And he's in a bathtub, and he's like, I'm going to have to kill myself because I cannot get old. I'm so beautiful.
He's got the hookah just like full of some opium.
Hookah for some reason.
Yeah. Well, he's taking copious amounts of drugs right now.
Right. Because he's dealing himself to kill himself. And he's like, I'm too beautiful to get old.
He's got that huge, beautiful mirror, and he's just staring at himself, and he's just like.
Meanwhile, I just want to. I don't know. I will talk about it later because I don't want to spoil something, but it makes no sense. But yes, he's like a young, beautiful young boy, and he's got the fucking straight razor, and he's about to slash his wrist.
If I were to age, if this world would see beauty decay, everybody would just
they would see
kill
the decay
themselves.
That makes the world rot. The scum that makes the world decay, and the world can't live without me.
Yeah.
And then his reflection, because he loves mirrors.
Yeah.
He loves looking at himself. We know that because he's beautiful.
Yeah.
And he's like, you want to live forever?
Hey, bud, do you want the sheets?
I want the sheets. And he's like, huh? And he's like, I can make you look beautiful forever.
I am so stoned. I'm talking to myself in the mirror.
And he's like, no, seriously. You just sign away your soul, and I will make you beautiful forever. You look like me. Of course, it's a reflection.
Yeah.
And he's like, you must be the devil. And he's like, yeah.
Some people call me that, but I go by many names.
And he's like, you got it. And so he gives him the fucking contract.
I don't know where the paperwork came from.
But here, there's always a thing. He's like,
devil went down to Georgia.
Your video will age, and you must look at it every day. You must see what you'll become. And if anything happens to this video, if it gets destroyed, you get destroyed.
Interesting.
And he's like, that sounds like a great deal. Where do I sign? And he signs with his own blood. And then we're like, oh, shit. So now we know his fucking weakness.
I like that as this tape is rolling, we get a bunch of cuts of Winslow's reactions. What great reaction. Like his horror, like in shock face and everything. It's so good. Again, with the black makeup smeared all over him, the mask and the fucking Darth Vader outfit. It's fucking great.
So apparently everything is on this tape because we also see...
Yeah, he's got one tape. This is like every fucking joke about recording to a VHS tape. Arrested Development did it. All of them do it. Always Sunny did it. So yeah, it rolls over into the next clip, which is of fucking, what's her name?
Phoenix.
Phoenix signing her deal.
Right.
She is he wants
her voice, yet he doesn't want her. He doesn't care about her voice. It's weird.
I don't get it. I thought some crazy, like, Kali Ma shit was about to happen with that later on, of course. But she's high as fuck, and she's giggling to herself, and he's in there like, hey, I want you to sign some papers. I already signed the consent forms. What are you talking about? You
can there's this weird thing. So, say... He wants to sign her voice over to him, and then he's like, "Kill her." I don't understand what this means. Like, how so he gets her disembodied voice? Like, I don't even know what he wants.
I mean, when you're working with out of this world forces, I guess. Yeah, I don't know.
He wants to sound like Phoenix. I don't know because he's so beautiful. I mean, if he had the voice of Phoenix and that beautiful face of Paul Williams,
I imagine it being something like Futurama: the heads in the jars. He was basically going to have a voice in a jar kind of deal, and whenever he needed to use it, he just pipe a wire to it, and then he could use it.
I don't know, but he finally gets her to sign over, and then he goes to his goon, looks like Tony Iommi, and he's like, assassinate her at the wedding.
But she's beautiful, boss. Who cares? I got her voice. What do I want with her? It's a fucking gross-ass carcass.
So, thankfully, I guess Swan, he thinks so much ahead. He has a little crow's nest for assassinations, for assassinations. A little hole area.
Building up into our big old crescendo
putting
here.
Putting the sniper together.
Yep. And, of course, Winslow happens to see... Oh, he's still in... what's his name? Swan's viewing room where all of his camera feeds.
Yeah.
So he sees this, like the assassin coming and setting up, and of course there's a camera right on him. So he's like, oh, another reaction shot. Those fucking reaction shots, man. Watch the movie for those alone.
And as he walks out, he destroys the room, sets it on fire. He just hurls like the machine, and it bursts into flames as it would.
So Winslow was planning on this, right?
I thought he was just
Swan. Because why else would he wear the mask?
I think it was just they wanted a big reveal. I don't think he was planning on it.
Yeah. It was coincidental.
Because probably so beautiful, people would get distracted. Like, their eyes would go off of Phoenix.
It's supposed to be about the bride.
Right.
And if he were there.
So he has, like, a little cherub-like mask on.
It looked like a ghost mask.
And he's always a showman. So there's a party already going on.
Oh, huge
party.
We got
women with big, like... fucking panties look like they got big bushes, and there's like crazy. There's a guy, a boogaloo boy with his fucking Hawaiian shirt rocking
with an
out.
AK just firing off rounds into the ceiling.
Everyone's having
because
like the fucking ain't no audience rowdy as a 70s audience.
And of course, again, we've talked about the assassination and everyone's questioning it, but he's like, what would get better ratings?
Right.
Again, this is the Trump mentality. Right. What would get better ratings than a fucking assassination on live
TV?
Because
that's the thing. He always has another plan. So he's like, he just wants to get the soul because he can get her soul. He doesn't even care. He's just like, kill her now. I like the satisfaction that I had her sign over her soul.
And think of the cassette sales. If they sold the normal, like the clean version without the murder, and then the fucking murder version, like 20 years later, like $50. He's going to make fucking bank off that shit.
Always thinking.
Always thinking.
And so Everything's ready. They're coming up from the stage, the bottom of the stage, are rising up. We got,
oh yeah, you got fuck it. I gotta point this out. Phoenix comes chicken dancing in yes, again, gets up on the stage, and then you got fucking yeah, you're right, Swan. Yeah. Slowly elevating, he's got a little lift. That
I love you brought up Ghost because Phil been looking like Papa Emeritus with his Pope outfit on.
Yeah, he's looking great.
And with the fucking mirror chits.
Yep, of course.
And then we see the assassin. He's just about, fucking Winslow's racing down this hall to catch fucking yeah. this assassin.
Cool shot too. I like a lot of the right. shots. And so you got that like camera rushing forward with them. Oh. Great.
And just as the guy's about to shoot Phoenix,
he just barely touches it. You think
we get the nice fucking crosshairs fucking yeah. shot.
With that full head of steam, you thought it would like right, like he slapped at the fuck. But no, he just barely touches it because he's right next to him.
Right.
So he only moves it an inch. But yeah, he manages to move it. Yeah.
It shoots Philbin right in the fucking neck.
Oh my God, it's a good shot.
Right. And while that's going on, remember, the fucking contract is burning. So... Swan's like, do you smell something burning?
Yeah.
And then he rips off his mask. And then I was assuming, okay, he would just be aged. No, his face is just melting off.
Melting, like fucking Raiders of the Lost Ark. Wait, is that the one?
Yeah.
Okay.
And he's like, my beautiful face, no!
And you got, well, yeah, did you mention Winslow fucking swooping yeah, in?
Yeah, hey,
style,
you guys!
Rips the mask in. Off. Yeah.
And then he just starts strangling Phoenix.
Well, it's a ballroom blitz, so right. all kinds of crazy shit's happening. And yeah, right. Swan starts strangling Phoenix because he's like, just give it to me now. Give me the voice. That's how you get a voice? Or he's got to kill her. He needs her dead because then the ghost of her voice goes in the air and he gets the jar and he catches it.
I think he's just like, I know I'm going to die and I'm taking everybody, much like Trump with his COVID, I'm taking everybody with me. So he starts strangling her. And then fucking Winslow busts in with a knife and just stabs
Not
his
a
fuck.
Knife, dude. He finds somebody had some costume piece that had a knife
oh,
in
yeah,
it.
Oh, yeah, because the women were dressed like crows. So yes. I think it was like a headdress type thing with a yes. beak. And he stabs him. And then his wound opens up that he did earlier because, like we said, if he dies,
the
he dies.
That's right. Okay.
Right.
Making more sense.
So fucking... like Winslow's freaking out, rips his mask off. His face is horribly scarred on the side.
Yeah, because they're dying together, just like we were told they
right.
would.
And so he's crawling to fucking Phoenix. Phoenix is like, I don't want nothing to do with any of this shit.
Yeah, he loses his mask because some dude is like, that's a fucking rad mask. Rips it off him and puts it on.
Yeah. You do not fuck with a 70s audience. It was crazy.
And again, I fucking love these shots. Again, crowd scattering. It's anarchy. And we're on the floor with Winslow as he's crawling and
towards
just gasping.
Fucking Phoenix. And she's like, ugh, can we be friends?
Yeah.
And she didn't see it. Well, she did see it earlier. I don't know why she was freaking out because she saw his face when he showed her.
Yeah.
But she's coked up. She doesn't know what's going on.
Yeah. Well,
and then when he finally dies, she's like, okay, now I can pretend like I care yeah. about him. So then she pats him on the head. You're nice.
You're all right. You shouldn't have died. You get to see all, like, we haven't really gotten too much close-ups of, like, all how disfigured
yeah,
he was.
Yeah, because it was really awful makeup. So
yeah,
I didn't get a lot of that.
I liked it, though.
Yeah, and that was it. It was a tragic ending.
Tragic ending. Unlike the apple where God descended in his Rolls
Royce.
That
would have been great if God had showed up and then
had a battle
with Satan.
I wouldn't have liked it for this movie. I liked that it was in the apple. I liked that this one went the other way with it. I liked that it was a tragedy.
Well, this is Schlachtober. This is horror. Horror should end with tragedy.
Yeah, exactly. I agree. 100%. That's why we didn't do the apple.
Right.
We are talking about doing the apple. We agreed every third month we would do the apple again.
Sure.
Thank you.
Something will come up every third month. Halfway. We're at the halfway point, Griff. So far, we've done slashers. We've done vampires. Now we've done Satan, basically.
We've done Paul Lynn specials.
Satan again. But what we haven't done...
Or just this month?
I don't think ever. I'm trying to think. I can't remember fuck all. But I'm assuming we've never done zombies. And Griff, zombies are hot as fuck right now.
I don't remember a zombie one.
Well, we're doing one next week. Because, like I said, Walking Dead, people love zombies. Actually, people are probably burnt the fuck out of zombies.
Have to imagine.
But we're going to bring them back because I got one question to ask you, Griff. Do you want to party?
Is that a real question?
No, it's party time next week, Griff, because we're doing the zombie classic from 1985, I think, Return of the Living Dead. It's punks versus zombies.
All right.
I can't wait. This is one of my favorite zombie movies.
Nice.
And it's a nice 90 minutes. I've been loving Schlocktober because it's hitting those 90-minute movies.
You can pack, this movie proves you can pack so much in 90 minutes.
And we'll prove it again next week because there's a lot of shit. I was shocked that it was 90 minutes. I thought it was like an hour 45.
90, Murray, this 90. Episode, 90 minutes.
The perfect night. So we're going to cut it right there. Keep it warm. See you next week.
We'll remember you forever, Eddie. Through the sacrifice you made, we can't believe the price you paid. For love, for love. Little Eddie Mitty, born in Jersey City, started singing when he was five. Never knew his father, mother didn't bother to catch his last name. Fast as he came, he was off and flying. Soon a baby sister, mama captured.